Monday, January 2nd, 2022.
And we're so happy you joined us today. We've experienced a lot of snow in the last week here in our region, and it just reminds me so much of what the scripture says about being washed white as snow and what Jesus does for us as he renews us and he washes us, and what he's doing and the plans he has for our region, for our city, for our families, and for the year ahead.
As we step into 2022 together as a church family, let's celebrate, let's worship, let's enjoy what God has for us ahead. Let's leave 2021 behind, all the faults, failures, whatever. It's a new year. It's a time to get a new Bible reading schedule. It's a time to dive into the Word together. It's a time to maybe start a new small group. It's a fresh start, and let's enjoy it together. Welcome to church!
Good morning, everyone. Happy New Year. It's going to be a good year. Amen. Amen. Let's just stand and worship the Lord, our God, for he is worthy. I can think of nothing better to ring in a new year than to lift up his name in praise and thanking him for all he's done. The scripture says, give thanks to the Lord, our God and King, for his love endures forever. Amen. Aren't you glad this morning that his love endures forever? So we're just going to sing that this morning. Here we go. Come on.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. We sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. We sing praise. Oh, sing praise. Oh, sing praise. We sing praise. We sing praise. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever.
Listen to that again. Forever God is faithful.
Oh, forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. From the rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever. And by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. We sing praise. We sing praise.
We sing.
We sing praise. We sing praise. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us.
there for a second. We're starting a new year, and the Israelites said this. They sang this over their tabernacle as they were dedicated to the Lord. They said, His love endures forever. This is the God of the Old Testament, the God of the Old Testament, but the Word of God says He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen. So no matter what's happened in the last year, let's leave that behind and let's look to Him and say, thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the challenges. Thank you for the victories, Lord. Let us be people that worship you, Lord. For your love endures forever. You are forever strong, and you're forever with us, God. We worship you this morning, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Who are we that you would be mindful of us? What do you see that's worth looking our way?
Come on.
We are free in ways which we never should be. Oh, sweet release.
Thank you, Lord.
From the grip of these chains.
Let's give Him our worship this morning.
Like hinges straining from the weight, oh, my heart no longer can keep from singing. All that is within me cries, for you alone be glorified, Emmanuel, God with us. My heart sings a brand new song. The debt is paid, these chains are gone. Be glorified, Emmanuel.
God says that he abides in the praises of his people. Let's just praise him.
It's a tiny offering.
Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord.
Compared to Calvary, but nevertheless, we lay at your feet, Jesus. Oh, such a tiny offering compared to Calvary, but nevertheless, we lay.
Again, all that is,
and all that is within me cries, for you alone be glorified, Emmanuel, God with us. My heart sings a brand new song. The debt is paid. Oh, these chains are gone. Emmanuel, God with us.
So it's a brand new year, a brand new time to set resolutions. And I say to you, set one resolution this year. And that resolution is to look up. Look up and see my face. Look up and see my throne. Look up and see heaven. Follow that star that is still there. That Holy Spirit will guide you and lead you as you look up, and life will then happen. As you look up, I will make things happen for you. I will clear the path. I will take out the obstacles that I don't want you to go through. I will help you through those that I want you to go through. But look up. That is your resolution this year. Look up and spend time with me.
My spirit living within you is not only meant for in case of emergency break class. I came to reside in you, every part of you, every moment of you, because I am committed to you in a way you cannot grasp yet. But in the fullness of time, you will get a better grasp. But understand, I'm there all the time. You've been freed all the time. You've been ready for me all the time, if you will allow that who resides in you to be fully expressed in everything you do, not just the best, not just hide the worst. I'm there all the time. All the time. And that is what I want you to focus on. The days will come and the days will go, but I am there all the time. All the time.
Place, I worship.
sing that again. You are here.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship. Darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you.
Yes,
I worship you. Miracle.
this morning as we worship. God, I pray that you would open up our eyes to see the Lord of heaven's armies is all around us, God. And Lord, we lay aside any disappointment that might have come from 2021. And we look to you, God, our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Because even when we don't see it or feel it, you're still working. And you never stop, God. So this morning, we just declare that again. Let's just sing that again, even when I don't. And just declare in faith over this church, over your family, over your life, that our God is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and he will be praised. Amen? He will be praised. Let's sing it out.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working.
Come on.
Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never
one more
stop.
Time, Lord God.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop.
God is a way maker, miracle worker, miracle worker. Lord, we repent of putting you in a box and thinking that you can't do miracles still today. Lord, we repent of not thinking that you can make a way when there seems to be no way. Lord, we repent of having a mindset that is that you can't. So this morning we come with fresh faith, Lord. Even when we don't feel it, Lord, we come and say, Lord, fill up our cup, God, this morning. Fill up our cup, Lord, to overflowing, even as we praise you. So this morning I encourage you, lift your hands with something that you need to give to God. If you don't feel comfortable, that's perfectly okay. But if you feel comfortable, there's a power in lifting up our hands and surrender to the Lord. And say, Lord, even though I don't feel it or see it, you're still working, Jesus. And we're going to give it all to you this year. We're going to give it all to you this year. Because that's who you are. That is who you are, Lord. That is who you are, Jesus. And we worship you, Lord. We worship you, God. Jesus, Lord. You're here in our midst, Lord. We give it to you, Lord. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper. Light in the darkness, my God.
That is who
we need to bring
are.
Some light to the darkness right now. Let's lift it up.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep light in the darkness.
Lord, we pray you bring light to the darkness, God.
That is
we pray you bring miracles in this year, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep. Light in the darkness. Oh my God, oh that is who you are.
You can change hearts, Lord. You will do it again.
Waymaker, miracle. light in the darkness. My God, that is who.
Declare it. That is who He is.
That is who You are. 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 That is who You are.
Thank You, Lord. Let's just take some time in His presence. I believe the Holy Spirit's moving this morning. Allow Him to speak to you. If you don't hear, just say, Holy Spirit, move. I open up my eyes and my ears this morning, Lord, to Your will. I encourage you all to listen to Him.
Jesus, Lord, it's who You are, Lord, who You are, Lord, who You are, Jesus. Take away my sin.
Thank You, Lord.
Keeper, the light in the darkness. Lord, you are so many things to us. You open up so many doors. You do the impossible for us. That's why we worship you. You're so great. You're so awesome. You're so wonderful. And Lord, let us never forget that. Let us never forget how great and how awesome and how wonderful you are. Regardless of what's going on around us, Lord, you are still great, awesome. You're still a miracle worker. And Father, I believe this year you have miracles for us to believe in that you will bring to pass. Just like you did last year and the year before. Lord, you did miracles. You did miracles in this church. And I believe, Lord, you're going to continue to do miracles this year. We're so excited, Lord, to live it out, to live our lives fully before you. To see what you might do with these humble vessels, Lord. You do amazing things with that which you possess. Possess us, Lord. Use us, Lord. We're excited for the adventure. You got a brand new life in store for us. Let it just be awesome in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Ah, man, we need to always remember how great he is. We need to never forget. You know, the children of Israel were carried into captivity, both by Assyria and then by Babylon, the northern kingdom by Assyria, the southern kingdom by Babylon, for one reason, they forgot God. One reason and one reason alone, they forgot God. I don't ever want to forget God. I don't ever want to forget God and how good he is. Regardless of what's going on, you're amazing, Lord, and we love you so much. With those with the word of knowledge, please come to the microphone at this time. If you're not familiar with the word of knowledge, it's where God just moves because that's what he does best.
Amen. There are those here, your left hip joint is in pain, and I think there might be a trauma associated with it, and God wants to heal that.
someone here. You may be online as well, and if you're online and that that fits you as well, please, this prayer is for you. I think we had somebody last service, if I recall right, that had an ailment that was online and got healed. So praise the Lord for that.
Lord, thank you. Thank you that you are with us, and thank you for giving us an opportunity to thank you for healing these hips. We speak to these whole joints that you would make them right in Jesus' name. Lord, thank you for the healing you've given, and thank you for our opportunity to praise you for your goodness. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Someone's got some numbness in the lower part of the left leg. So same leg maybe. It's numb, knee down to toe somewhere there, and God wants to touch and bring healing.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Thank you again, God. You revealed these things because you are here moving in our midst.
Thank you, Lord.
You're healing, oh God. You're moving when we don't even see it. And Lord, we thank you that you were stirring and doing your purposes in these legs before this was even spoken. And so we stand on what you've revealed, not to remind you, but to remind these legs that they must submit to the lordship of our God. Let healing
thank
come
you,
in
Lord.
Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Well, as you return back to your seats and that, greet everyone and say, Happy New Year! My goodness, a new year, 2022. Can you believe that? Remember in the year 2000, we weren't supposed to survive. We didn't know whether the computers were going to make it from 1999 to 2000. We thought the world was going to end or something, the computers were going to take over. It was going to be 2001, A Space Odyssey. Something was going to happen. We didn't know, and nothing happened. We just got through it just fine. God is so good. It's amazing. Can you believe, Curtis, that was 22 years ago? 22 years ago. My goodness. That is crazy. Anyway, thank God for 2022. God's got great stuff in store for us. I'll kind of bring what I feel is on our God's got for us as a church body in the messages coming up here. But today we've got a great message by Amir Owens. I'm very, very excited about it. It's going to be absolutely incredible. But if you're new with us here, would you do me a favor? In the pew rack in front of you, there's a connection card. Please just take it out, fill it out. Let us know a little bit about you, any questions you may have, any prayer concerns. We want to make sure that we answer those questions and connect with you in any way possible. The last thing I want to say before I send it back to our greeters is that we have our Living Faith Fellowship app, okay? This year, it's a little bit different, which is really cool. You get an opportunity for two different Bibles you can read. You can read the YouVersion Bible. They have it on here for you, just right from our app. And also Bible Gateway, yes, is the other one. So there are two options there. If for some reason yours didn't come up and repopulate, just go and go back to the app, the one that's more white with a little blue cross in it. If you go back to that app and say update, if you update that, it'll repopulate everything and you'll be off for the year. It's going to be really, really good. I'm really, really excited about it. So anyway, let's get back to our online greeters. I believe Pastor Dan and Hannah.
Thank you, Pastor Phil. Welcome, church family. This morning, we are joined not only by everybody here in the building, but also we have people joining us all over the Palouse and even in the state of Colorado. So we're joined by quite a few people today.
Incredible. And they also receive the word of knowledge. The Holy Spirit's moving in this room and outside of this room as we gather together. And God fulfills his promise that says, wherever two or more are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. What a privilege to be the family of God. What a privilege this morning to hear from a man of God, a man of faith, a man I respect very much. Please put your hands together and welcome with me Amir Owens.
Thank you very much and Happy New Year. But how about we go ahead and give God a praise? Amen. How many felt the power of God in the building during worship this morning? Worship team, that was awesome. God, I felt so refreshed in my spirit. There was so much peace in my spirit. Thank you, worship team. You guys did an awesome job this morning. Again, Happy New Year. So happy to see all of you in the year 2022 and to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Again, I just felt the power of, I was emotional, the power of the Lord, power of the Holy Spirit was just moving this morning. It was so fitting this morning because I want to talk about the power. Amen. How many of you guys have ever lost power when you needed it most? I already see hands going up, right? Ladies, you know, you're just out of the shower and you're just on the fringe of being late, but you're still on time, right? And you're blow drying your hair and the power goes out and now you're definitely late. You thought you were on time. Guys, we know how it is. We were already late, but they thought they had time and now the power's out, blow dryer's not working. We're definitely late now. She'll even admit we're gonna be late, right? Fellows, we're in our garage, we're working in the shop, you know, we're building something and then our power tools just suddenly become tools. There's no more power, right? We just got a tool. We're like, what do I do with this? What about spiritually? Have you ever felt like you've just lost power spiritually? I know I have. I know I've been in situations in life where I felt like I've lost my power and it leaves you confused. It leaves you frustrated. It leaves you scared. Amen. I don't think I'm the only one there, but I've been in situations where I've lost power spiritually, but it's so important to keep that power, amen? Amen. This morning, I want to talk about the importance of that power. Coming from Romans 8, starting at the first verse, and we'll work our way through it down to the 17th verse. It says, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us who do not live according to the flesh, but live according to the spirit. When I read this, there's just so much life. There's so much freedom. There's so much power in this passage of scripture. That I needed to learn how to be better at walking out in my own life. Man, when he talks about in the very beginning of the verse, he says, therefore, there is now no condemnation. And I know for myself, and sometimes I think it's true for everybody, we can read the Bible and we can read scriptures like this. There's therefore now no condemnation. We can read it very casually and not really understand, not really grasp the power that's in the scripture, not really grasp the full promise that God has given us. But Paul wants to accentuate and make it known to us how powerful the scripture is. Because when he says that there's no condemnation, he's saying that you're freed from the penalty and the condemnation of sin. The word no here is really emphasized. It means not even one. There's none. There's nothing, never. My stepdad was from Texas. He's from down south. He would have said it like this. He would have said, not one iota is what he would have said from being from down south. That we're not judged as a sinner. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter what you're going to do, that you're not judged as unrighteous. In fact, the rest of the verses tell us that we're set free from the power of sin and death and that we're counted as righteous. But it's important because it says for those who are in Christ Jesus. God has been challenging me in this, in walking these truths out in my own life, in such that I feel like I have a good grasp on the promise that I'm free from the power of death. I know and I believe that God sent his son, that Jesus Christ died for my sins on the cross, that he got up on the third day and that he's sitting at the right hand of the Father in heaven. And because of that, I have eternal life. Like I've got a strong hold on that. I know that when I die, I'm going to heaven. But God's been challenging me to walk out the truths every day in my life that I'm free from the power of sin. Amen. That's a truth that I haven't got a full grasp on, that God's challenging me. You can do better than that. God's challenging me that, you know, the way that I respond to people, my attitude, The way that I get frustrated in situations, the way that I'm frustrated at home with my family, God's challenging me that you are free from the power of sin. You don't have to respond that way. God's saying that you have been set free from the power of sin. And I often, I don't like the way that I respond. It's not how I want to, but when I'm operating in my flesh, that's just the natural reaction because my sin nature is corrupt. My flesh is corrupt. And I know that I walk away from the situations like there was no benefit that came out of that when I snap on my kids. There's no benefit when I come down on my wife like that. I walk away from the situation oftentimes like what came of that? Now my kids just know dad's mad and my wife's just thinking like, what's the next thing that's gonna set him off? Like, and it's not the way that I wanna react, and I walk away from that condemning myself, listening to the lies of Satan saying, you know, well, you're just always gonna be that way. You're not good enough. You don't know how to raise a family. You're not gonna be, but those are the lies of the enemy that condemn me. But the problem is sometimes I fall into listening to those lies. I find myself like Paul in chapter 7 when he says, we know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual. Sold as a slave into sin, I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. Like I said, I don't like how that made my family feel. He said, for in my inner being, I delight in God's law, but I see another law at work in me, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work in me. What a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? And I love the 25th verse. It says, thanks be to God who delivers me through Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. I have 3 points that I want to share with you. And the first point is that there is power in your position. The first thing you have to realize is that you have a choice in your position. Paul says that there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ. That is a choice and position that you have to be in Christ. To be in Christ means that a person's faith in Christ places them in Christ. Positionally, as a believer, you are placed in all that Christ is. Christ is your representative. He is your agent, your substitute. He's your mediator in life, in death, and in resurrection. Amen?
Amen.
In a similar way that you, as a believer, are considered to be a representative or an ambassador of Christ on earth, horizontally in our relationships with one another, Christ is that same representative vertically with God for us. Amen? Our family went to Whitefish over Christmas, and it was awesome. We have a few pictures here. We had an awesome time. I have my beautiful kids. These guys are amazing skiers. They're some rippers. They blow my mind every year we go back that there's like the retention that they keep in the skills that they learn. It's like they pick up right where they left off like a year later. It's not gonna be long before I can't keep up with them skiing on the mountain. We have some more pictures here. The girls made some epic snow angels. We had a lot of snow, so that was a workout actually to move that snow around and create the snow angel in that deep of snow. That was a lot of fun. And the last one here, that's us on the ski lift. That's me and the kids. And my father-in-law, Rocky, the kids, Poppy, we had so much fun. What's really cool about every time we go out there is my father-in-law and my mother-in-law, for our Christmas gifts, they buy our whole family passes to ski. They buy the kids, season passes, and they buy Devin and I frequent skier passes, which are basically a discount in it, a discount to ski, a discount in all the activities on the mountain. It's really cool. But the cool thing is, like, my father-in-law paid for a season's pass on his account at the mountain. Then he bought our frequent skier passes. And when you buy a season's pass, there's oftentimes a ton of benefits that you get with a season's pass. Sometimes you can go ski at other resorts. If you're on the mountain, there's restaurants, there's shops you can go to, and you can get discounts because of your season's pass. What's awesome is that my frequent skier pass is associated with his season's pass on his account. So when I'm on the mountain, because of my position with my frequent skier card, I have access to the same benefits that he has because he bought a season's pass. I didn't buy a season's pass. I didn't buy the frequent skier pass for that matter. They got it for free. That's the same thing Christ did for us. Christ came down to earth. He lived sinless, and he died for our sins on the cross. And because of what he did, we have access to all the same benefits that Christ has in heaven. How awesome is that? How awesome is Christ for doing that? Amen? When a person believes in Christ, God places and positions that person in Christ. The believer is identified with Christ, just like I was identified with my father-in-law when I was on the mountain with my past. The person, the believer, is identified with Christ. The believer's faith causes God to identify the believer with Christ, to count the believer as sinless and righteous only because Jesus was sinless and righteous. That reminds me of the book of Genesis in the 15th chapter. It talks about how Abraham believed the Lord, and he was credited to righteousness. And I love that passage of scripture. God brought that to me and gave it so much life. I've read it so many times before, and we've often done that. We've read something so many times, and then one time you read it, it just, boom, it hits you in the face. But I love it because it said that Abraham believed the Lord. There's not even a comma. And then it says he was credited as righteousness. Abraham didn't do anything. In an instant, there was a spiritual transaction, and because simply of his belief in Christ, he was credited as righteousness. That's all it takes for you to be in Christ Jesus. All you have to do is believe. There's no works associated with it. God didn't say, Abraham, if you do this, this, and this for the rest of your life, I'll give you righteousness. As soon as he believed, he was credited with righteousness. And Christ is saying, that's the same thing that you have to do, is believe in me. I don't care who you were. I don't care who you are. I don't care who you're going to be, the things you're going to do. If you have faith and you believe in me, I will credit you as righteous. That's awesome, and I love that. The word believe here says to build up or support, to foster as a parent or a nurse. Abraham believed that God was going to build him up, that he was going to support him in whatever it was that God told him to do, that he was going to foster him. And the definition of foster here is to encourage or promote the development of something. And as I'm going through life and I'm dealing with family situations and I'm not handling them right, and oftentimes my position is in question. Where am I at in Christ? Am I really in Christ in the position he wants me to be, or am I operating in my flesh? And what God wanted to do was develop something in me. He was trying to develop something in me when the Holy Spirit's convicting me, telling me that that's not right. You shouldn't respond that way. You need to apologize. What God was doing was fostering something in me, trying to develop and encourage me in something. To be in Christ means that a believer walks and lives in Christ day by day. To truly walk in Christ means we do not walk after the flesh, but we walk after the Spirit. Acts 17:28 says, for in him we live, we move, and we have our being. It reminded me of what Moses said to God. He said, God, if your presence doesn't go before us, don't send us up from here. And I often wonder, how fast do we move without the leading of the Holy Spirit? How fast do we unplug from our power source in the Holy Spirit? Paul continues in verse 5. He says, those who live according to the flesh have their minds set on what the flesh desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. What God told me is that you're single-handedly disrupting the peace in your home, because your mind is being governed by your flesh, because you're acting selfishly, because you're treating your family the way that I would not treat them. The fact of the matter is, God said to me, he said, if I responded to you the way that your behavior warranted, how do you think that would make you feel? But I don't respond to you that way. I respond to you with compassion. I respond to you with grace. I respond to you with understanding. And he said, if I respond to you that way with compassion and understanding when your behavior warrants an overreaction, or your behavior warrants me lashing out on you, and I respond with grace, how much more should you respond with grace to those around you? God said, I was single-handedly disrupting the peace in my home. Talk about conviction. And that's like Pastor Phil talks about in Carpenter series, the enemy condemns with broad general statements. You can't point purpose to them. But God convicts with pinpoint precision. And that's what God was doing in my life. He was giving me actionable steps on how to be a better father, how to be a better husband, how to be a better leader and better minister inside of my own house. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. God, please keep me out of the realm of the flesh. Amen. It's like Paul said in chapter 7, a war is being waged in the law of my mind. Those whose mind is in fleshly desires act selfishly. They obey impulses of the flesh. They live to gratify the desires of corrupt nature. They cater to the body. Conversely, those whose mind is on the Spirit, what the Spirit desires, they rise above flesh and blood. They live for things that are eternal, and they are occupied with the things of the Spirit. What God's dealing with me is that you've got to become occupied again with me. You've got to become occupied with the things of the Spirit. That means you've got to be occupied with the Word of God. That's why we have what Pastor Phil was talking about, our daily Bible reading. And it's the second day of the year, so if you've missed that the first day, you've got plenty of time to catch up so you can be on track with it. Amen. But we've got the flyers in the back for our 2022 schedule. If you don't have it on the app, you can get these on your way out. But we have our Daily Bible reading, which is awesome to keep your mind set on what God desires. Amen. The Bible is the mind of God written out. So if you're going to desire what the Spirit desires, you probably should know what's on God's mind. Amen? Amen. We have prayer. We have 24-hour prayer every first Friday of the month. We have worship services, and we have a ton of service opportunities. These are things that our leadership, our senior pastors, put in place with a purpose so that we can be occupied with the things of the Spirit, so that our minds can desire what the Spirit desires. In other words, what God is saying is there is no middle ground. And we know this, but it's really easy to fall into the trap of the enemy, amen? 1 John 2:15-16 says, do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in them. For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life comes not from the Father, but from the world. Revelation 3:15-16 says, I know your deeds, that you are neither hot nor cold. I wish you were either one or the other. So, because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. The fact of the matter is, we're either feeding the Spirit or we're feeding our flesh. We're either for God or we're against God. We can't play both sides of the fence. Proverbs 23:7 says, for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Philippians 4:8, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, noble, right, pure, lovely, and admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think on these things. See, where a person keeps their mind and what they think about determines who they are and what they do. Where a person keeps their mind and what they think about determines who they are and what they do. If you know me by now, you probably know where I'm going with this. The Holy Spirit was telling me in my heart, you better get your mind right. Amen. The question here in verse 5-8 is, do you desire what the Spirit desires? In my time with God, that's what he was asking me. Do you desire the things that I desire? The second point is that life through the power of the Spirit is high voltage. Verse 9 says, you, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal body because of the Spirit who lives in you. You have to know that you have the power of the Spirit of the same God that raised Jesus Christ from the dead living inside of you. The Holy Spirit is mentioned 19 times in chapter 8. I think Paul is trying to tell us that there's something important about the Holy Spirit here. The Holy Spirit was acting as my spiritual defibrillator. If you guys know what that is, you watch the doctor shows and they rub those two metal things together and clear, boom, and then they shock the person who's in cardiac arrest. That's what a defibrillator is. You did that to me. That's what a defibrillator is. Amen. The Holy Spirit was acting as a spiritual defibrillator in my life. I come to find out, so CPR is, you know, chest compressions, mouth to mouth, to help resuscitate someone. But what I found out is that CPR can only do so much because the real issue is an electrical issue internally. CPR manually pumps the heart, and mouth-to-mouth breaths will manually exchange some oxygen, really not even that much, I found out, because mostly of what we exhale is carbon dioxide. So that in itself is almost not even that beneficial. But CPR is mainly a manual way to pump the heart, but the heart needs to be able to pump on its own. And so without the use of a defibrillator, shock therapy, 70% of cardiac arrest patients either die or survive with severe brain damage. That's how important a defibrillator is to someone in cardiac arrest. Spiritually, I was in cardiac arrest and I needed God to restart my life spiritually. Amen? And this is where I was going wrong. Like, I completely overestimated my own problem. I completely overestimated my own strength in the problem. I was trying to give myself spiritual CPR. I was trying to tell myself, like, you can't do this. That's not the right way. But I'm telling myself that, trying to operate in my own self, trying to will myself out of operating the God that doesn't want me, operating the way God doesn't want me to. And I underestimated the power of the Holy Spirit. I forgot what verse 3 said in that, for what the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by my flesh. Paul already established that the law was holy and that the law was good. This only emphasizes how incredibly weak and wretched my flesh is. I'm incapable of keeping a holy law in my flesh. I was plugged in to the wrong power source. I didn't have enough power in myself. It's kind of like this. Have you ever been in a situation where you needed just a little bit more power? So this is my JBL. It does a pretty good job for me. I'm usually pretty satisfied during a workout. I think it pumps out some pretty good juice. You guys can tell me how you feel about it here. That's pretty loud, right? You can hear that. Hear that lion roaring? That's a decent amount of power, but what about this? That's got a little more juice, doesn't it? See, I didn't have enough power in and of myself to change the things that I needed to change in my life. I needed the power of the Holy Spirit. Because Christ came, died, was resurrected, and ascended, the Spirit of life has power to do so much that's outlined here in this scripture. The Spirit of life has the power to remove condemnation. He has the power to give life, to pull the mind to spiritual things, to dwell in the believer, give life to the spirit of the believer, to put to death evil deeds, to lead the believer, adopt us as sons, and bear witness with our spirit. That's power. I was thinking back on Pastor Tom's recent message that Christ, you know, was born in you, and Pastor Dan's message of prepare him room. And I believe that the Lord wants to stir up the desire in his church that we, the local church, would stir up the power that he's placed in us to do our job, to walk according to the spirit and not to the flesh. Paul has repeatedly told us in his letters to either walk or live worthy of your calling. Here in verse 12, Paul drew a conclusion and made application from his previous discussion. He says in verse 12, therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. Each believer's responsibility is a positive one, to live each day in the control and power of the Holy Spirit. We have an obligation to the Holy Spirit, for it is the Holy Spirit who convicted us. It's the Holy Spirit who revealed Christ to us. He imparted eternal life to us when we trusted in Christ. Because he is the Spirit of life, he and only he can empower us to obey Christ. He and only he, the Holy Spirit, can enable us to be more like Christ. The last point There is power of continuous connection. Verse 14 says, "For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you will live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you receive brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are God's children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we may also share in his glory." At the beginning of Romans 8:14, it says, "For those who are led by the Spirit of God." The phrase "are led" means to bring, to drive, to go, keep, lead away. But I love the last one. It says to be open. It says that that reads, "For those who are open to the Spirit of God," open to being led by the Spirit of God. You have to be open to the leading of the Spirit. He's not going to force you. And you cannot resist the Spirit. I've been doing some plowing for Palouse plowing, and I was covering a route where I had to do some de-icing, and I had never done it before, so I got a small tutorial on how to get the motor going and get the pump running so the big boom will spray the icer out of the back of it. But when I got on the site, I did everything that I knew was right. Started the motor, I turned the flip on run, or the switch up on run, but it wasn't coming out, so I had to call my boss, and I hope I didn't wake him up. But I told him I did everything that I was told, but it's not coming out. So he FaceTimed me and he told me to look at the back of the motor. And he said, "There's your problem. Your lever's closed. You need your lever open if you want the de-icer to be able to flow." See, oftentimes the problem is that our levers are closed off to the flow of the Holy Spirit in our life. We have to willingly be open, continuously open to the leading of the Spirit. It's not enough for us to have the Holy Spirit. The Spirit must have us. The Spirit's not just for us to tap into when we need something. We need to be open to the Spirit so he can flow in us whenever and however he wants to. I'm going to close with Paul's letter in 2 Corinthians 3, 7 and 11. It says, "The old way, with laws etched in stone, led to death, though it began with such glory that the people of Israel could not bear to look at Moses' face, for his face shone with the glory of God, even though the brightness was already fading away. Shouldn't we expect for greater glory under the new way? Now that the Holy Spirit is giving life, if the old way, which brings condemnation, was glorious, how much more glorious is the new way, which makes us right with God? In fact, the first glory was not glorious at all compared with the overwhelming glory of the new way. So if the old way, which has been replaced, was glorious, how much more glorious is the new, which remains forever?" That's awesome. Moses had a mountaintop experience. But as soon as he came down and left the presence of God, the glory began to fade. I thank God that I don't have to have mountaintop experiences. Amen. Where I come to church on Sunday, and by the time I wake up Monday morning, the glory is faded. I thank God I don't have to have those kind of mountaintop experiences. I thank God that when we're in Christ, the veil is lifted. That when we're in Christ, we have power to put to death evil deeds. We're in Christ, we think different and we talk different. The Bible says that therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. When we're in Christ, we have the power to be changed. Remember, to be in the right position, be properly sourced with the power of the Holy Spirit. Know the power of the Holy Spirit is high voltage, and stay connected to the right source. Thank you.
you haven't written those down yet, I would. Really good. Really, really good. Amen. So here's my challenge for living it. We talked, you led a great worship song, such a tiny offering compared to Calvary. And what the Lord said to me is, it's not about how much, it's about its completeness. So every offering is enough as long as it's everything. The widow's mite was enough because it was everything she had. Our lives surrendered to Jesus Christ is enough because it's all we have. So the question is if we're going to live in the Spirit's power, then the exchange is all of Him for all of me. So Lord, today, just in response to what Amir spoke, to what the Spirit is saying, to what you're doing afresh in us this year, you've given each one of us words, challenges, affirmations for the things that are to come this year. Lord, we just say, have all of me. Have all of my thoughts, have all of my efforts, have all of my dreams, all my hopes, all my aspirations. All the things that I want to hold on to, Lord, I surrender them to you afresh again because I want to live in the Spirit's power. And Lord, where we've wandered from, where we've moved from your presence, before your Spirit departed, before it moved on, before you said it's time to break camp and move on, where we've reached out in our own strength and our own effort, we just ask, Lord, that you'd forgive us now. You'd wash us. You'd cleanse us. And you'd remind us that we have nothing without you, but in you, we have all things. We receive it now in Jesus' name. Lord, you can have all of me. In Jesus' name, amen. If you've got more work to do along those lines today with the Lord, I encourage you to come up to the altar and don't leave today until you are sourced correctly in the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. Got some announcements for you as we close up today.
That's right. Hey, it is a awesome time in the house of the Lord. This morning was so great to be with you all. This Wednesday, we have Wednesday worship service again at 7 o'clock, so don't miss it out. It'll be great. And then Saturday, we have church family chores starting up for the new year. So if your last name is A through B, let's go. 10 to 12. Come join us.
A through B. A through B. All right, 24-hour prayers coming up. Amir mentioned that. I love that. He said, these things are opportunities our senior pastors in Leading with Vision have provided for us so that we can give our all for Christ, so that we can be connected to the power sources. So as we come and give time for 24-hour prayer, I think what we do is we invite the power of God to not only touch us and change us, but change our community. So please look for an opportunity to sign up for that. It is an amazingly charged time. Bring a friend with you. Bring someone to pray with you. It's not just a lone soldier thing. I'm going to take this and soldier through, but bring someone with you to pray through the things of God together.
That's right. Last year, a lot of us read through the Bible, and this year, guess what? We're going to do it again. Come on. Let's go. So it's on the app, the Bible reading schedule. There's the basic reading plan, which is second half of the Old Testament and the New Testament in Psalms. There's a plus, which is the whole Bible. So let's go. It's on the app. If you have any issues with the app not working, see Catherine Davis, and she will get you squared away. I like you too. We should be friends.
We are friends.
Yeah. Let's play basketball tonight. What are you doing?
I'm not going to play basketball.
What? Fine.
I bounce more like a basketball than I play like basketball.
It's not true.
We were doing the online segment before, and you guys should hear it. Shagun, if you're online, man, I love you so much. He just said this. He said, I can't wait to get back to Pullman. Do you know why? It's because of you guys. It's because of what the Spirit of the Lord does in this community. Seriously, that's a great thing. That's a great thing. How good and pleasant it is for the brethren to dwell together in unity. Let's enjoy the fellowship of the saints and the work of the Lord in our lives. It is a privilege to be at church together with you. God bless you guys. You're dismissed.
way to kick off the new year. And I don't know about you, but I felt so challenged by Amir's message today about living our life powered by the Holy Spirit. And I know that I need that for this year. I need that for today. I need that in my relationships. I need that at work. And so I want to encourage you today to take some time before you go to bed to really get with the Lord and to open yourself up to Him and to posture yourself to live in the power of the Holy Spirit today and then for the rest of this year to come. What an incredible way to start off a new year. Thank you so much for joining us. We are delighted to have you online. And on behalf of Pastors Phil and Carrie and our entire church body, have a wonderful Sunday, and we'll see you next week.
You have been watching the weekend services of Living Faith Fellowship, a Spirit-filled local church serving the communities of Pullman, Moscow, and the surrounding region. We are a group of people who love God and believe in His power to change lives. If you responded to the teaching today or have any questions about Jesus, the Bible, or how to grow in your walk with God, we would love to get in touch. If there is anything we can do to serve you, please let us know. You can connect via social media, our website, or by calling the church at 509-334-1035. God bless you, and have a wonderful week.